Hello and welcome to lecture 8 in Introduction to Machine Learning. Today we will talk about how to train neural networks. In the last lecture we introduced neural networks. So here we will look at a particular type of implementation of the gradient descent algorithm for training neural networks. So the algorithm that we will talk about is backpropagation algorithm. It's an efficient implementation of gradient descent, and it is needed because we have several layers in a neural network, and we are going to do forward calculations anyway. Layer by layer we are going to compute the outputs of every layer and feed them as inputs to the next layer and so forth. So while doing so, with a few extra calculations, we can store the information that is needed for computing the gradient for such a large layered and complex function which is the neural network. So it's nothing but gradient descent, but we save partial derivatives as we go forward, and then we link them back together using chain rule of differentiation when we come back. So just to revise, in neural networks you have an input layer, and the input layer, the size of the input layer or the number of neurons in the input layer is decided by what is your input size, what your input dimension is. So if your input dimension is D, then you have D neurons in the input layer. Whereas your output layer is, the size of the output layer is decided by the dimension of the output. So if you have a multi-dimensional regression problem, you have n different quantities to predict, then you will have n different outputs. If you have n different classes, probability mass function of n different classes to predict, then also you will have n outputs. You can get away with n minus 1 outputs in that case too, but usually it's easier to just have n outputs. And your final layer activation function will also be decided based on what kind of problem you are solving. So for regression problems, your final layer activation will be linear for regression. That means there will be no activation function. And it will be softmax usually for classification. And then all the other hidden layers that you have. So your input layer has no activation function, it's just passing the inputs. But for hidden layers, you have a choice of different activation functions. Popular choices are sigmoid and tanh. And the third one is rectified linear unit. So rectified linear unit is currently the choice that seems to have better properties in terms of training neural networks and getting higher accuracies. But you cannot apply ReLU blindly to the output layer. There you have to see what kind of problem you're solving. So now let's look at how this backpropagation algorithm works. So basically this backpropagation algorithm is based on chain rule of differentiation. So if you have functions nested inside functions, then it is handy to use chain rule of differentiation. So for example, the layers of a neural network, these are functions of a function. So basically you can think of your x as being an input into some layer, and what comes out of that is, let's say, a1. And that A1 is the output of the first layer, and that becomes input to the second layer, and what comes out is A2, activation 2, etc. And all the way it comes, what comes out at the end is, let's say, AN. Okay, so these all these layers are in series, and what we have is, this is the most the function that is the inside most function, and then it is fed as an input into another function and so forth. So these are functions of functions, and the way you could write that is that your input is being operated upon this function h, and that is your first layer, and what comes out of h is given as an input to the function g, and that is nested, so h is nested inside g. So let's say your complete function f of x is a nested function with g of h of x. Right, so it is also written as g with a circle, h with a circle of x. Now let's say if we want to find these derivatives, right? So if we want to find the derivative of f with respect to x, then what we will do is let's introduce some intermediate variables. So let's call h of x as y. Let's call g of y, which is g of h of x, right? That is your z. That is your f of x. Let's call it z. So your derivative of f with respect to x is nothing but dz by dx, which by chain rule of differentiation is going to be dz of dy and then dy by dx, dz by dy and times dy by dx. So we have and these individual derivatives may be simpler to compute, but when you multiply them together, you can compute the derivative of a much more complicated function. And we can simply write this as g dash of y times h dash of x, and at the point where we are computing. So what is this y? Y is the value of h of x at the given input x. All right. So here's an example. So let's say you have d by dx of sine x square. So we know derivative of sine x, we know derivative of x square. So we are going to basically put this together in chain rule. And in chain rule, what we will get is the derivative of the outer function, which is cos of x square, derivative of sine of x square, and then times the derivative of x square, which is 2x. So these two get multiplied, and this is how we get the derivative of a more complex function. So this same concept is going to be applied in neural networks. So before that, let's try to express a neural network as a computational graph. So what is a graph? In a graph is a collection of vertices and edges. So the circles and the squares that you see in this figure, these are the vertices. A singular would be vertex. And then the arrows that you see, these are the edges, or in this case, directed edges, because they go from the tail to the head of the arrow. They don't come back. If there is no arrow, if it is just a single line, then it is called an undirected edge. Here, these are directed edges because the information flows in the direction of the arrows. And let's assume we have a two-layer neural network where everything has dimension 1 for convenience. But later on, we will see how to expand the dimension so that we can deal with vector derivatives, we can deal with matrices of weights and vectors of biases and so forth. So, but for now, let's assume that everything is just a scalar. So let's say we have an input x, right? And the neural network is such that you have input x, and then basically we multiply this with weight w1, okay, and then we put it in some function, sigmoid function, but let's just call it f function. We put it inside an f function, and we also add a bias b1 to it. Let me draw this where I have more space. So let's say I have input x, and it goes into a function f, right? And into that function f, we also have bias b1, or I will have bias b1 as the weight, but I will multiply input 1 with that. And here I have w1 being multiplied. And what comes out of that is multiplied with w2. And then I have 1 multiplied with b2. And this goes into a function, activation function g. And then comes the output. And that output, I want that output to be close to a target value t. Right? So that is your entire neural network, a two-layer neural network. Later on, we will see what if x is a vector instead of a scalar. What if, and because of that, your w is a matrix, because the output of the neural network is also a vector, which is the number of neurons in that layer, and so forth. So the computational graph is going to look like this. So whenever you see a circle, circles are variables, okay, and squares are functions. And then arrow is the flow of information. So here we have xi, and so you can see that no variable goes to a variable, no function goes to a function. A function has to give input, a variable has to give input to a function, and the output is stored in another variable. And then some variables are not named here, so I will just leave them as a question mark. But there are some that are named, and I will show you what those are. And we'll use some convention. But before we go to that convention, let's look at the basics. we have the variable x, which is the input, which is being multiplied with w, and this is the multiplication function. And once these two are multiplied, we get some output. And then we have the addition function in which we add the bias b1, and what we get out is a variable z1. Okay, so here now I want to introduce a convention. I will use zi for all the outputs of the linear combinations. So let's say once we have the or the affine combination. So basically, whenever we have weight times the input plus bias, that output I will call it zi, I being the layer index, okay, not the input index. I is the layer index. So z1, z2, z3, for layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, etc. And then once that z goes into the nonlinearity, which could be a sigmoid or a ReLU or a tanH, the output of that nonlinearity, we will call that as AI. So A1, A2, A3. Okay. So because this is a two-layer neural network, we don't count the input layer. We just count the hidden layer and the output layer. We will have Z1 and Z2, and we will have A1 and A2. So now this Z is being fed into this nonlinearity F, right? So it's a function. So again, it's a square. It's a rectangular box. And then what comes out of that is A1. Now A1, so here is your first layer. So this is your first layer, and this is your second layer. Okay, so the output of the first layer is the input to the second layer. So we have, so this is layer one and this is layer two. Okay, so the operations to the left of this line are all the operations in layer 1 to produce this output A1, which becomes input to the layer 2. Now this input to the layer 2 is now multiplied with weight W2 using this multiplication function. And then an unnamed variable comes out of it, and we add a bias B2 to it, and that is this addition operation. And what we get out of that is Z2, right? So this Z2 is the output of this linear combination of the input to this layer, and then we apply a nonlinearity to it, and what we get out of that is A2. Okay, so this is the output of your neural network. The A2 is the output of your neural network, but the story doesn't end there. We want this A2 to be close to the target variable T, so we put that into a function L, which is the loss function. Right. So basically, if it is, for example, if it is a regression problem, we will take A2 minus Ti whole squared, which is the mean square error. Or we would take, if this was sigmoid, then we would take cross entropy loss. So whatever that is, we get this loss function L, and what we get out of that is the loss. Right. So now what we want to do is we want to train this neural network. So we want to find the minima of the loss with respect to changing W1, changing W2, changing B1, changing B2. Okay. So we want to compute the derivative of the loss with respect to all four unknowns, which is W1, W2, B1 and B2. Right. But for the most complex one, for example, would be computing the derivative with respect to W1. So let's look at how that will happen. And that's where we will use a chain rule. So in this chain rule, this is the linear operation of the first layer, which gives you Z1. So this thing that I have highlighted with the red bracket, that is Z1. Once we get Z1, we give that as an input to F, and what we get out of that is A1. So this bigger bracket is A1, and then A1 is input is multiplied with W2, and we add B2. So this is going to be Z2, and then it is given as an input to G, and what we get out of that is A2. So this is the layered structure of the neural network, and then we put that inside the loss L, right? So that is the final bracket, the final layer. So we are treating loss also as a layer. So now we want to minimize this loss. So we want to go towards the negative side of the gradient. We want to compute the gradient of L with respect to W1. Actually, we also want to compute the derivative with respect to W2, with respect to B1, and with respect to B2. But we will skip the other three, because it will be obvious how to do that once we look at the most complicated case, which is the derivative with respect to w1. So here we are applying chain rule, and what the chain is basically going backwards from the output, from the final thing that we are computing. So what we are saying is that it's nothing but saying that we will take the partial derivative of the loss with respect to a2, then multiply it with the partial derivative of a2 with respect to z2, and then partial derivative of z2 with respect to a1, and then partial derivative of a1 with respect to z1, and then partial derivative of z1 with respect to w1. That's basically what we will be doing. So that's nothing more complicated than that. So that is what is reflected here in the chain rule. We have the nearest variable to L, which is a2. We will compute that derivative, and then we will compute the derivative of a2 with respect to z2, and then dot dot dot. I introduced some dots in case it was not a2 but al, some large number of layers. Here we have only two layers, but what if we had four layers or five layers? Then this series would have continued, and we would have had then finally we would have del of z2 with respect to a1, then a1 with respect to z2, and then z1 with respect to w1. So this is how we will compute the derivative of the loss with respect to the deepest of weights, which is closest to the input. Okay, so you will notice that in this entire chain rule of derivatives, there are two types of terms that come again and again for multiple layers or pair of layers, two consecutive pairs of layers. So one is the derivative of zi or zl, if you are talking about the lth layer, this should be L, sorry, the derivative of ZL with respect to AL minus 1. So derivative of Z with respect to the output of the previous layer or the input of this layer, and that is going to be WL. And the second derivative, type of derivative you will see, is a derivative of, for example, AL with respect to ZL, right? And that is going to be the local derivative of the activation function f dash. Where does that come from, right? So let's look at it carefully. Let's look at this expression, right? In this expression, if you look at the derivative, so if you look at this f, right, inside the f is the z, right, and outside the f is the a. So if we look at del a by del z, or del al by del z, del zl, l is the layer number, then that is basically the partial derivative of this f, which is whatever f is. So if it is sigmoid, right, or if it is ReLU, whatever is the point derivative at a particular point of that function, that is basically what del al by del zl is. Okay, now where does the first thing comes from? Where we have del zl by del al minus 1 is wl. So if you look at this particular expression, right, and you take its derivative with respect to a, what is a? A is actually, in this particular case, it is x, okay, which is the output of the previous layer, okay. Or if you look at something that is outside, then this is going to be a for the next layer. So that is being multiplied with the weight of that layer. So when you look at the output of the linear term, this entire term with respect to x, then that is just going to be w1. If we look at the derivative of this entire term with respect to what's the output of f, then we are going to get w2. Okay, so that is how we say that del of zl by del of al minus 1 is going to be wl. So now that we know how these partial derivatives are computed, let's look at what is this computation graph is good for. So whenever we use a library to define a neural network, inside that library, like a PyTorch library or TensorFlow library or what used to be Theano library, there is a computational graph forming whenever you are using their own their own functions, library functions, to define the layers of a neural network. And that computational graph is formed so that precisely so that you can do chain rule without having to think about it, and the library computes the derivatives for you for any function, any nested function. So the way it happens is that once we have defined this computational graph by defining the layers, every time we are computing the output of the neural network using an input x and some values of the weights, we are doing a what is called a forward pass. So forward pass is basically just sending the information from input to output. That is basically what forward pass is. So in forward pass, basically your information is flowing this way. So x is being multiplied with w, and whatever comes out of it, we add the bias to it. What we get is z, we give that as an input to a function, and what we get out of that is a, and then we multiply that a with w, and whatever comes out of it, we add the bias b2 to it, and then we get z2, we give that as an input to g, and whatever comes out of it is a2. And this is the output of the neural network, but we also compute the loss, so we compare it against the target value t, and put it inside the loss function, and what comes out of it is loss. So we get both t and the loss as the outputs of the neural network. Now that is the complete forward pass, and that we will do for every training sample when we are training the neural network, because we want to compute f. We want to compute both f and f dash. So this forward pass computes your f. F is not this f, but the not this f, but the entire function of the neural network. So basically the forward pass is computing the function, let's say capital F of x, where f is the entire neural network, and the backward pass will compute f dash of x, at that given value of x. And how will that be computed? So that is basically we are taking the partial derivative of the loss with respect to a2. Now notice that we don't need to compute the partial derivative with respect to t, because t is not varying, t is fixed. Your target variable or the target value is fixed. So we are computing the derivative of loss with respect to a2, and then your g function is fixed. We are computing the partial derivative of a2 with respect to z2, and multiplying this in the chain going backwards. So this partial derivative gets multiplied with this partial derivative, gets multiplied with this partial derivative, and if we are computing the derivative with respect to b2, then we don't need to do that. We just basically compute the derivative of z2 with respect to b2. That is a side step we can take, but I'm talking about how to go deeper into the neural network. And then again we will take the partial derivative with respect to z1, and then we will take the partial derivative with respect to w1. So we can take partial derivative with respect to w1 as well as v1. Here also we can take partial derivative with respect to w2. So these are all the partial derivatives that are being computed, and whatever is in the chain gets multiplied, right? So when we are doing the forward pass, at that time itself we can compute the partial derivatives and store them locally. What does that mean? So we know that the what is this derivative of z1 with respect to w1, what is that derivative going to be? So that is basically going to be xi. Okay, so here your derivative is xi. What is the derivative of a1 with respect to z1? That is going to be f dash at the value z1. Okay, what is the partial derivative of z2 with respect to a1? That is going to be this w2. Okay, and what is the partial derivative of a2 with respect to z2? That is going to be g dash at the value z2. Okay, and what is the partial derivative of loss with respect to a2? That is going to be whatever is l dash, okay, at the value a2. Okay, so now we can multiply these coming back, but during the forward pass we can store these partial derivatives locally at each node, that what is the so that we can use it while coming back. Okay, so here Another thing to notice is that we didn't worry about B2 and W2 and B1, but that can also be done. So what is the partial derivative of Z1 with respect to B1? That is going to be just 1. What is the partial derivative of Z2 with respect to W2? That is just going to be A1. What is the partial derivative of Z2 with respect to B2? That is going to be just 1. Okay, so these are all the partial derivatives that you need for computing the derivative of the loss with respect to W1, with respect to W2, with respect to B1, with respect to B2. Just follow the chain from the loss to the parameter whose partial derivative you are trying to compute and multiply everything coming back. But we compute it and store it locally going forward. So going forward, all we need to do is we need to store the partial derivative of f dash at this point. We need to store the partial derivative of z1 with respect to w1 at this point, which is going to be x1 or xi and so forth, right? So that's local storage of partial derivatives at those operating points is basically what makes it efficient, makes the gradient descent more efficient. Otherwise, if you have to analytically derive the derivative, then it's going to be very cumbersome, especially for deep neural networks. So the backward pass is basically just the multiplication of locally stored partial derivatives, and that is basically what the backpropagation algorithm is.